Christian Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Aging with Grace, Flourishing in an Anti-Aging Culture by Sharon Betters and Susan Hunt, narrated by Marie Hoffman. The righteous flourish like the palm tree and grow like a cedar in Lebanon. They still bear fruit in old age. They are ever full of sap and green. Psalm 92, verses 12 and 14. Foreword. Karen Hodge, Women's Ministry Coordinator, Presbyterian Church in America. When do you start to finish? Today is the day. Inside every older woman is a little girl, trying to figure out who she will be when she grows up. We long to flourish and thrive, not just in old age, but right here and now. When I was 29 and struggling with this question, and by the way, I still am, Susan and Sharon entered my life. I watched and learned the shape of godliness from their lives. I can testify, after serving alongside them 20-plus years, that they are still full of sap and green. Psalm 92, verse 14. Now they have written what they have learned about aging with grace. This is the book I need now, and it's the book I want to give to younger women. Are we promised tomorrow? Today is the day. The Word of God describes life like a mist or a blade of grass. Psalm 103, verse 15. Our season for flourishing is fleeting and temporal, but eternity is forever. Living in light of eternity impacts not just us, but our children's children. But the steadfast love of the Lord is from everlasting to everlasting on those who fear Him, and His righteousness to children's children, to those who keep His covenant and remember to do His commandments. Psalm 103, verses 17 and 18. This book reminds us to begin with the end in mind, that our reference point for life is God, and that His Word is our authority. The grass withers, the flower fades, but the Word of our God will stand forever. Isaiah chapter 40, verse 8. Do you desire to flourish to the finish? Today is the day. Remember, my friends, we are not running this race alone. We are surrounded by many who were faithful to the finish. Run with the women Sharon and Susan introduce us to in this book. They will disciple you to lay aside the life-taking thinking and actions that encumber you. Run with women in your church by studying this book together and helping one another divert your gaze from the worldly anti-aging culture and fix your eyes on Jesus. A leader's guide is available. Start running, sister, and run until we get home. Hebrews chapter 12, verses 1 and 2. Only one life twill soon be past. Only what is done for Christ will last. Now join me in a conversation with Sharon and Susan. Karen Hodge, when did you start thinking about aging? Sharon Betters, my husband Chuck was 21 when he became pastor of a small church. Because my childhood pastor's wife taught a Bible study, I thought I should too. Every week, five elderly women sat at our table and let me teach them. Who did I think I was? Yet they loved and encouraged me, listening as though I knew what I was doing. They were life givers. But there also were a couple of elderly women who scared me with their sharp tongues and criticism of my husband's preaching and leadership. They were life takers. All of these women were rooted in the church, yet not all of them offered kindness and love. That's when I started my quest to understand God's view of aging and how I could intentionally prepare to be the sweet, life-giving old lady who encouraged young women just starting out in life. Susan Hunt, I think my obsession with thinking about being an older woman was largely due to my passion for and commitment to the Titus Chapter 2 mandate that older women are to teach what is good, and so train the young women. Titus Chapter 2, verses 3 and 4. I wondered when I would be an older woman. Now, my aging body assures me I am one, and I love the perspective from this season of life. Karen, what prompted you to write about aging? Sharon, even though we are both older women, I'm 72 and Susan is 80, it's doubtful either of us would have thought about writing this book. However, a workshop I was asked to teach on purposely preparing for old age resonated with older and younger women. I laughed when some of them asked me to write a book. Susan, when Nancy DeMoss Walgamuth asked me to speak on the Titus Chapter 2 Older Woman for a True Woman Conference, I was shocked at the response from women of all ages. Sharon and I began discussing the question, what does God say about aging? We studied scripture and prayed. Between us, we have 42 children and grandchildren, including spouses. We were compelled to write what we learned for our generation and theirs. It feels outlandish to write about ending well when we haven't ended, but we do not write only about what we have experienced. We write about what God's Word tells us. We are awestruck by His calling and promise for this season of life. Karen, why do you believe our culture is anti-aging? Sharon, American culture idolizes youth and measures value by what a person produces for society. When older people stop contributing financially through working, show signs of wear and tear, and slow down mentally and physically, culture considers us worthless. Some see the elderly as a drain on society. Why wouldn't I dread aging when I have been trained to chase after youth and do everything I can to slow down the inexorable march into old age? Unless we are purposeful in fighting the throwaway anti-aging messages with a biblical worldview, we will face this season with fear, dread, and denial. Susan, secular psychiatrist Carl Jung first coined the phrase the afternoon of life and defined it as 56 to 83 years of age. He said, wholly unprepared, we embark upon the second half of life. Or are there perhaps colleges for 40-year-olds which prepare them for their coming life and its demands, as the ordinary colleges introduce our young people to a knowledge of the world? To answer Jung's question, the world cannot prepare us because it has no hope or power to give us. Culture's false narrative about aging is the church's opportunity to proclaim the hope and power of the gospel, to equip God's people to flourish, even in old age. Karen, how do you approach the topic in this book? Susan, our approach is very simple. We asked the Lord to teach us how to glorify Him as older women. We studied the scriptures, and we share some of the things we learned. We alternate. I write a chapter on thinking biblically about aging, using Psalms 92 and 71. Then Sharon writes a chapter on living covenantally in old age. This was an interdependent endeavor. Our ideas flowed into each other's work. Our voices became one in our desire to glorify the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Romans chapter 15, verse 6. Sharon, throughout Scripture, we often see an explanation followed by an example. The Living Covenantally chapters are examples of the explanation in the Thinking Biblically chapters. We don't consider ourselves experts on aging with grace, so we selected older women in Scripture who illustrate the principles in Susan's chapters. I soon knew I was on holy ground. I often paused and whispered, What am I missing? Tell me your story. Let me get inside your skin and show me the treasures hidden in your soul. I am forever changed by getting to know these matriarchs better, and we pray you will be too. They show us what aging with grace looks like, and how this is not an independent endeavor. It happens in community with God's people. Karen, is there a prevailing theme you do not want readers to miss? Sharon, yes. We want readers to truly believe that the Bible gives us not only the promise of bearing fruit in old age, but it also gives us a roadmap to grow and flourish in this grace. We want readers to ask, what if aging, though challenging, is not a season of purposelessness, but rather an opportunity to discover our true identity in a way we couldn't in the first half of life? What if we purposefully prepare for the afternoon of life while we are in the first half of life? And for those already in the afternoon of life, perhaps ill-prepared, feeling worthless and rudderless, we want them to know it's not too late to experience God's grace and through His work, make an eternal impact in this season of life. Susan, our point is that aging with grace, or what the Bible calls growing in grace, is impossible apart from God's grace. When the disciples asked Jesus, who then can be saved? Jesus looked at them and said, with man, this is impossible, but with God, all things are possible. Matthew, chapter 19, verses 25 and 26. This book is not a list of ideas to become a gracious older woman. It's about the lifelong adventure of God giving His children the desire and ability to do all things, even aging with grace, through Him who strengthens us. Philippians chapter 4, verse 13. We have no nifty formulas to give you. Actually, there's nothing new in this book. But we don't need anything new. God has given us the means of grace, His word, prayer, worship, sacraments, fellowship, to grow in our relationship with Him. And He says to us, stand by the roads and look, and ask for the ancient paths where the good way is, and walk in it, and find rest for your souls. Jeremiah chapter 6, verse 16. So come walk the ancient paths with us as we explore God's promise and provision for aging with grace. Sharon, we asked some of our friends who are at least 70 to tell their stories. We are confident their stories will disciple you, as they have us, to age with grace. Their stories embody the message of this book. So we offer two of them to read before you begin chapter 1. Ruth's story. Ruth Offerth partnered in ministry with her husband Bob for over 46 years, most of that time in Newark, Delaware. She has 3 children, 13 grandchildren, and 4 great-grandchildren. Hundreds of women claim Ruth as their spiritual mother. She was widowed at 73. I'm 88 years old and live in Gainesville, Georgia. In this season of life, flourishing means being overwhelmed by the difference between my receivings and my deservings, as an old Puritan observed. Looking back on my life, I see God's sweet hand of providence again and again. Each day is a gift. Now that life has slowed down, I have more time to study the scriptures. And oh, how much more precious that time has become. God's thoughts jump off the page with encouragement and joy that can be applied to the exact situation I am facing. Early mornings on my porch I pray, satisfy us in the morning with your steadfast love, that we may rejoice and be glad all our days. Psalm 90, verse 14. In praying for family and friends, I confidently ask, make us glad for as many days as you have afflicted us, and for as many years as we have seen evil. Psalm 90, verse 15. Yes, the days of affliction come. Part of flourishing is fervently grabbing hold of the Lord through His promises. He says, draw near to God, and He will draw near to you. James chapter 4, verse 8. Gladness comes with His presence. As you grow older, expectations change. You come to realize that there is no perfect family, church, situation, or society. Because we live in a broken world, we begin to marvel that things go as well as they do because God gives grace upon grace. We look for His intervening hand of love as we work through difficulties. Struggling and rejoicing can happen at the same time as we let the struggles bring us closer to God's warm embrace. Another gift God gives for our flourishing is the local church. Active participation in a shared faith makes us a real family as we worship, sing, pray, serve, rejoice, and sorrow together. We find joy when people respond to the gospel. After years of teaching Bible studies, I now attend several women's studies as a student, where I find younger women are hungry to hear from an older woman. The Lord also gives me the privilege of counseling at the local crisis pregnancy center. Finally, I am focused on God's promise that surely goodness and mercy shall follow me all the days of my life, and I shall dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Psalm 23, verse 6. Diane's story. Diane Balsh and her husband Dave spent 44 years establishing various lay ministries nationally and internationally. While they were living in New York, she directed the women's ministry at Redeemer Church. She has 2 children, 6 grandchildren, and 2 great-grandchildren. I began the year with a month of reflection. Advice from 40 years ago, when I faced a life-shattering trial, resurfaced. Don't look back, except to thank God for what He has pulled you out of or brought you through. Then ask, what am I going to do with what I have left? As I reflected, I remembered. When Dave was diagnosed with inoperable lung cancer, we prayed the prayer that never fails, Thy will be done. God gave us peaceful hearts, and Dave arrived in heaven 7 months later. We were passionate partners, crazy in love. After 54 years of marriage, I grieved deeply, and I worshiped more deeply than ever before. When my colon cancer surgery and recovery were heaped onto 10 years of chronic Lyme disease, I prayed for strength to trust the Lord with all my heart. I grieved the loss of independence, but I knew the peace of His presence with me. When I pondered how long I should remain in a home, church, and community I loved, I prayed, as I approach 79 years, is it time to make my 25th move and go to another state? My month of reflection produced clarity only God and His Word can give. It's time. Let go. So I've let go of teaching the Bible after 45 years, leading women in evangelism and discipleship efforts, Titus-2-ing with teens through 80-somethings, and loving all of it. I've let go of my home, furniture, and keepsakes, and moved west, only to return 2 months later to my southern community and church. The Lord led me through a trial to see where I belong and why. Weary after months of letting go, I've shed tears, counted blessings, and known Jesus' presence and comfort. It's been hard, but I've found freedom. I have been sorrowful, but always rejoicing. 2 Corinthians chapter 6, verse 10. My reflections also reminded me of what I will not let go, trusting God's promises that Christ is in me, His grace is sufficient, and His power is made perfect in weakness, and praying for unsaved or suffering family and friends. So what am I going to do with the time I have left? My answer is the same as it was 40 years ago. Make it count. Only the Lord who directs my path knows what that will look like. I may flounder, but He is faithful. Oh, how I love Jesus. A note from the authors. From Sharon. Prolonged church conflict, life-threatening breast cancer, loss of our 16-year-old son Mark. Add to these the care of our family and life as a pastor's wife. Jesus wasn't joking when He said, "In the world, you will have trouble." The Lord did not put me in a sweet cocoon of grace during these dark times. I often wrestle to reconcile His love with His sovereignty. Here's the good news. Jesus finished His dire warning in John chapter 16, verse 33, with this promise: "Take heart, I have overcome the world." He did not reject me when I struggled to trust Him, but instead held me tightly in His grip, where I experienced unconditional love and learned to trust Him once more. I experienced His faithfulness in ways I never thought possible. I wrote this book out of the context of years of experiencing Jesus's overcoming grace in my life. Your story may be similar or different, but I pray this book will encourage you to trust His overcoming power, no matter what path He calls you to walk. May we look forward to arriving home, where we will fully experience the victory won by King Jesus. From Susan. A few weeks after this book was submitted to Crossway, my beloved husband Gene died. He was sick for only about 3 months, and until the last few days, we thought he would recover. He was a vibrant, active, joyful man. His life was a celebration of the power of the gospel. Seeing him lying in a hospital bed, getting weaker by the day, was shocking. But it was a sweet and sacred journey, as our children, grandchildren, and I were with him to his final breath on this earth. It is important to me for you to know this book did not flow out of that context. This book was completed before Gene's homegoing. Writing this book was God's gift to prepare us for this season of suffering and sorrow. I don't think it would have occurred to me in the fog of fatigue and uncertainty to think about either of us flourishing, but I had learned from Psalm 92 that the righteous will flourish, even in old age. My prayer for both of us was shaped by this promise. So as you read this book, my friend, I want you to know I can now put big exclamation points on every page. God's grace is sufficient, and His grace is specific. When it's time to age, He gives aging grace. When it's time to suffer, He gives suffering grace. When it was Jean's time to die, the Lord gave dying grace. And now, He is giving me grieving grace. An Aging with Grace Leader's Guide with lesson plans may be ordered from 1-800-283-1357, www.pcacdm.org/bookstore. Thinking Biblically. 1. Wonder and Worship. Psalm 92, verses 1 through 4. Susan. Our granddaughter Susie was about 4 when she slid down the stairs on her pillow just as her mother rounded the corner and saw her. Thus began the following conversation. Susie, don't ever do that again. Did you do this when you were a little girl? No, my mother wouldn't let me. Who is your mother? Surprised she did not know this, her mom answered, "My mommy is my mother." Without flinching, Susie replied, "No, she's not. She's an old lady." Susie is now 24, which makes me a very old lady. But here's the thing. I have been happily married for 56 years, have 3 children, 12 grandchildren, and 1 granddaughter in love. You have to be an old lady to have these amazing blessings. The world tells us aging is our enemy, and we should fight it. The Bible says it's our friend. Wisdom is with the aged, and understanding in length of days. Job chapter 12, verse 12. Let's be real. Aging doesn't feel very friendly. Change is disorienting because we settle into our roles and responsibilities and they become our identity and purpose. And now we face almost daily changes of diminishing physical abilities and energy. We need something bigger and better to make sense of it all. We need an identity and purpose that transcends it all, which is exactly what God provides in the gospel. The gospel is big enough, good enough, and powerful enough to make every moment of every season of life significant and glorious. The one who created us promises we can flourish and bear fruit. We can be full of sap and green, even in old age. Psalm 92, verses 12 through 14. These lively words indicate growth and vitality. They seem to contradict my reality as an 80-year-old who suffers with inflammation of the connective tissue in my body that causes pain and weakness in my muscles. But this promise of growth does not mock my physical reality. It transcends it. The gospel imperative to grow in the grace and knowledge of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 18, does not have an age limit. The same grace that gives us new life in Christ empowers that life to develop, mature, and flourish. We never finish growing. There is always more grace to experience and more to know of Christ's love. This growth is gradual. We don't produce it. But as we trust and obey God's word, we can anticipate it. We had almost finished writing this book when I fell, damaging muscles in my neck and jaw that caused severe headaches. My kind doctor told me, "At your age, this will take a couple of months to heal." I spent many days lying in a dark room, sometimes wondering what it would mean to age with grace if I never got better. I prayed, "Lord, what does it mean to flourish and be fruitful right now when I do not feel like doing anything?" I reflected on Psalm 92 and prayed that He would make me glad. Psalm 92, verse 4. Some days I fought fears and fatigue, but I began to realize I was not afraid. I was content, and I knew Jesus was with me. I thought, this is not wasted time. It is growing time, because my physical weakness and pain push me to trust Jesus more. My heart is full of an ineffable gladness. Honestly, I'm shocked by that statement. The only explanation I can give is the one Jesus gives to Paul. "My grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness." 2 Corinthians chapter 12, verse 9. So let's walk the timeless and timely path of Psalm 92 with expectant hearts, eager to know how to flourish and be fruitful as long as we live in these earthly bodies. Psalm 92, verses 1 through 4. A song for the Sabbath. It is good to give thanks to the Lord, to sing praises to your name, O Most High, to declare your steadfast love in the morning and your faithfulness by night, to the music of the lute and the harp, to the melody of the lyre. For you, O Lord, have made me glad by your work. At the works of your hands I sing for joy. The title of Psalm 92, A Song for the Sabbath, indicates this is a communal song that was used in the context of worship. Notice how Sinclair Ferguson connects flourishing to worship. It is at the end of life, not only at the beginning, that Christians are most different from the rest of the world. Then the true beauty of a woman, the true character of a man, is seen for what it really is. That is why there sometimes seems to be a touch of glory and light about the lives of elderly Christians. They have remained fresh and green, as Psalm 92 suggests, because their hearts have been given to the Lord in worship. True worship puts character into our lives, humility into our bearing, strength and confidence into our witnessing. Let us learn to worship God with the faithfulness and joy of the author of Psalm 92. The psalmist's unbridled joy in God is contagious. His God-centeredness is compelling. What is the first thing that comes to your mind when you think about God? Our answer is one of the most important things about us, because it reveals the arc of our life. It determines the choices we make and shows whether we understand that our identity is not based on what we do, but on who we are in Christ. The psalmist leaves no doubt that his knowledge of God is not a product of his imagination or his circumstances. It is the product of God's revelation of himself in his word. God reveals himself through his names. Note the two names the psalmist uses in Psalm 92, verse 1. Lord is the English translation of the Hebrew word Yahweh. This is God's personal covenant name, whereby he reveals himself to us as the covenant-making, covenant-keeping God, who enters into a personal, forever relationship of love with his people. His covenant is his marriage bond with his chosen ones. The very mention of Yahweh immediately reminded the elderly Israelites that the Lord never stopped loving or pursuing them, even when they sinned. For us, on this side of the cross, this name brings an even fuller understanding of never-ending covenant blessings, which include God's covenant plan that began in eternity past when the Father chose us in Christ and predestined us for adoption through Christ to the praise of his glorious grace. Ephesians chapter 1, verses 4 through 6. His covenant promise in Genesis chapter 3, verse 15, that he will rescue us from Satan's bondage by providing an offspring of the woman who will crush Satan's head. His repetition of this promise throughout Scripture, I will be your God, you will be my people, and I will live among you. See Genesis chapter 17, verse 7, Exodus chapter 6, verse 7, Deuteronomy chapter 29, verses 10 through 13, Jeremiah.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.